slip you some Boogie Wee Willith for the Fringe FM. Coming at you live from the middle of nowhere, the center of everywhere, here once again to give you yet another dose of conversational boogie. This is Shift Happens. Oh, buddy. Ba-da-boo. Do follow us on Twitter at Shift Happens Pod. Follow me, Gigi, over at GigiRabbit1. And joining me tonight, as per usual, is our associate producer, Brad Harris. You can follow him on Twitter, ADS Brad Harris. What's happening, Brad?
Yeah, baby. Back in the chair. How's everyone doing? Just so amped. Every time I get ready for the show, I forget about the music. Yeah, that's the best music any radio show has for the intro. I have to say, hands down. Sorry, you guys. That's my opinion, and the EODM, baby, Eagles of Death Metal. That's how we roll on the intro. One of the best bands. Actually, they just played, I think it was a couple weeks ago in my area. Unfortunately, I had the show to do, so couldn't make it. But yeah, Here I am today, enjoying the music as usual. What have you been up to, Gigi?
Yeah, man, I wanted to go to that too. And if you guys, if you ever hear somebody talk about Eagles of Death Metal, and you wonder what they sound like, well, they sound like this. Just like you thought, right?
And it's so far from death metal. I love it. It's just like a kind of an inside joke. It's great.
Yeah, there actually is an old inside joke about that, actually. But a story for another time. Hey, what's happening, folks? What's happening, Alan? Long time no see, brother. Eric, Kat, Dan James, K28. Oh, by the way, K, your book will, for some reason, I guess it's the holidays or whatever, but yeah, shipping your book took a long, it's not going to be there till next Wednesday. So yeah, but you will have it next Wednesday, rest assured. I'm not sure why. Like, I understand, during Christmas, obviously, the mailing slows down, but what's going on right now? What are people mailing, frozen turkeys or something?
Snail mail, baby. That's how it rolls. But yeah, frequent flyers, welcome in the chat room. It's always good to see you guys. And of course, we got a frequent flyer coming back in tonight, Preston Bennett, discussing his new book, of course. And man, this last book that I read, the underwater UFOs, man, that was a great book. In fact, I got a lot of photos I just shared right now. If you guys want to check it out on Twitter, you can check it out at ADS Brad Harris. And on Twitter, I just posted some of this stuff that my buddy brought in. He did a private charter out with a sonar outside of Huntington Beach, just west 40 miles out, and came home with some staggering stuff. You guys are the first ones to see it. We're not breaking it yet anywhere else. So please go there and check it out. You're going to have your mind bombed, as usual, with our show. So yeah, check it out.
Yeah, man. Now, okay. It's funny, Dan's saying in the chat room, talking about the school sightings out there in Australia in 66, the Westall sightings. And me and Preston were just talking about that right before the show. So, we'll definitely be getting to that. And, speaking of books and mailing, we will be giving away one signed copy of Preston Dennett's new book, Schoolyard UFO Encounters, 100 True Accounts, which is obviously what we will be talking about tonight. And so what do you think, Brad? What, should we give it to the funniest comment of the night, or should we do a call-in, or should we do the best question of the night? What do you think?
Well, man, I have a couple ideas. We could just do an MVP, the MVP, the most valuable personality that can come in either direction, or we could just be just kind of give an easy one. Like, how many books has Preston Dennett wrote? Don't Google it, you guys. That's cheating. So don't be doing that. But off the top of your brain, you got to just, put your fingers into the etheric vibe and just be like, okay, what is it? What's the magic number? I want that book. And then you will have that number. So let's see what you guys got. Let's start there.
Well, I like the MVP idea. Because people are just going to cheat. There's no way around that. So, but how about this? Just whoever at the end of the night, who just an overall, you know, accumulation of whether it's, you know, being in the chat room and having good questions or calling in perhaps later in the show, what have you. I'll just, you know, somebody's going to shine tonight in the chat room, as someone always does. And whoever that is, whoever's the MVP, will give that book to someone.
Well, you know, he's written a gazillion books, so whoever gets the actual number right is not the winner, but the closest person to that.
Okay.
I don't know. We'll figure it out as we go. It'll be fun. So let's do it.
We'll chew on it. We'll chew on it. But nonetheless, by the end of the show, one of you lucky folks will be getting a signed copy of his new book. And so there you go. Now, a pretty big week, especially in the life of a Gigi, because now this is for dorks, obviously, but Shenmue 3, after 20 years of its fan base, self-included, yelling and screaming at Sega for making the third game after the biggest cliffhanger in storytelling history, which is where Shenmue 2 left off back in 2001. All these years later, after crowdfunding, breaking Kickstarter starter records, and really the community actually made this game happen, finally came out this last Monday, November 19th, a day that shall go down in history. And I'm so proud of a community of dorks. It's absolutely unbelievable. I mean, we literally have just been complaining for 20 years, and then they finally, you know, we're just like, dude, you cannot leave us hanging like that. And really,
we need dork support, man. Dork support. Yeah.
Well, the problem was Sega had rights to the IP, but Yu Suzuki and his whole team were the ones who actually made the game. Sega just owned the intellectual properties, and for years they just weren't letting it go. And all we were saying is, dude, give the license. You created, you know, Yu Suzuki created all this stuff. Just give it to him. Let him finish it. And we will fund the game ourselves, literally. And that's what we did. We raised $2 million in the first 24 hours. And then about $10 million altogether. And the game was fully financed by us. So, you know, that's a good life lesson there. If you really want something done, you can just keep complaining. And it might happen.
The cool thing with the game community, too, is, like, there's ears, you know, and I mean, that's some of the biggest money, you know, out there right now in production is, man, those games, they make a lot of money. So why wouldn't you do it? So hats off to you guys and supporting what you thought was, you know, something worth it. And here you are, happy again. Let's do that.
And, you know, that reminds me, too. Yeah, Shenmue 1, and those were the most expensive games ever made at the time, the first two. It's actually in the Guinness Book of World Records.
Is it really?
Wow. I mean, the record's been broken now, but back in, you know, 2000, 2001, yeah, there was just the massive production, and it's influenced so many games that came after that. It was, you know, it's like the Michael Jordan of video games or something. That was a terrible analogy, but you know what I'm trying to say. Just an OG effort, and yeah, so I was really excited about that. Unfortunately, I haven't even played it yet. I don't even have a PS4, so... kind of ironic.
Coming up. Maybe Santa will bring you that PS4 that you need.
Yeah, kind of ironic. But nonetheless, it's out. We did it. We did it. Also, like we were talking just before the show about the music on this show. Pretty much the you know, the guy, the myth, the man, the legend, Josh Homme, who's really the brains of all this, of all the desert rock, you know, Queens and Eagles of Death Metal. He was just on Joe Rogan's show. Also on Monday. Yeah, pretty cool to, you know, he doesn't usually do podcasts or interviews or anything, you know. So it was really cool to see that. Definitely a good episode. And so, yeah, as far as Gigi goes and everything that Gigi likes, this has been a pretty cool week just with Monday alone. that was all on Monday. So, yeah, pretty exciting week. And I'm going to be going back to Houston for the Turkey Days. I'll be leaving tomorrow, and I'm going to be gone for about almost 2 weeks. And being that the case, I don't think we're going to do a live show next Friday. You know, we're all going to be with family. Everybody's got their boogie going on. So we'll try to pre-record something for you guys next Friday. And also this Sunday, Cortana and I will be doing a live B-side episode with some folks from the Halo community. More video game dorkery. That's right. And it's going to be a big roundtable discussion about what all this hoopla is going on right now in the Halo community, which I'll be honest with you guys, I don't know. That's why I'm going to be mediating the show, and it's going to be a roundtable discussion about all this controversy around the Halo IP. And so that'll be this Sunday at 5 o'clock Pacific. So, yeah, there you go. And, yeah, that's pretty much our plans here. Now, let's see. Oh, did you get those photos out, Brad, of the underwater?
I just put them out. I got a couple more to put out, but I want to just see the last two that I have to put out. I want to wait to just see if people are even interested in it, and if they are. I had some weird connection with it. There was I don't know if you guys heard, there was like this new story out. The backstory of this is kind of crazy. I don't know how much I buy it, but in the long run, it's definitely something worth checking out. Is that this USB flash drive that was found in a parking lot in Germany, recently. And apparently it has like over 1,800 photos and videos of, anomalies and certain videos that have been taken that we've never seen before. Some of them NASA, some of them, I don't know where it came from. But one thing I do know, I saw a lot of close-up orbiting video of anomalies on Mars that represent the same exact structure and distance. You know, it's mind-blowing. I don't really want to drop those yet until I look at them a little bit more. But they represent identical pictures that my buddy took with the sonar, west of Huntington Beach. I don't know if I was too tired when I was looking at them. It was like first thing in the morning, like right before work. It was like the god-awful time of like 4 a.m. Anyone that gets up at that time, I mean, that's not meant for humans. But anyways, those that have to do it, hats off to you, because I'm one of them. And these two cones that look identical to the cones that were on Mars are right there off, the coast with some other amazing things that look like an airplane. There's like a half circle or like an oval circle of like perfectly spaced out lit up domes. Like there's domes underneath the water that are lit up. And I'm like, man, that could be a civilization that's been there. We haven't even really touched on that. So I'm not really trying to claim anything yet. I'm just trying to soak it all up and just throw it out there to you guys, see what you think, so check it out. And then also check out, Twitter, ABS Brad Harris pictures. Let me know what you think. Look up this this USB flash drive. I'll give you guys a link to that later on. And you can have fun this weekend with it and just, tear it up or trip out on it, whatever you got to do. But I'd love hearing everybody's response on it, because that's kind of how we work. You can want to believe something so much that you think it's true until you have someone like Gigi saying, oh dude, that's a freaking, that's a cone from a whatever or something, so it's always good to toss it up, throw it around, and see what we can come up with, guys. So yeah, that's what I got for you this week.
And retweeted those photos you tweeted out. And also, by the way, Eric tweeted out a couple minutes ago, says that Preston Dennett is the best ufology researcher currently in America, officially, according to Eric Awakening Man. So
I agree.
He's
got more books than anyone else in the field. So, man, he's got like the eyes and the brains and the strength to put it all together. So hats off to you, brother. Thanks for coming again and getting out here on the show.
Yeah, and that when Eric makes a statement like that, he really means it. So there you go. And I really am interested to see what comes of all these images on this USB, USB drive. Now, isn't it, 1,800 or 18,000 images on there.
1800 plus. I can't remember the exact number, but it's a whole boatload of pictures, man.
And it's
going to take you a weekend just to look at them all and decipher which ones are keepers and which ones are lame. And that's what I heard is I haven't really got to get into it, but I heard, you know, there's some pictures that look fake. So it's like, you know, I don't know. Maybe some of them are real and they're just trying to just mask it a little bit with some fakeness so people just think it's all fake. I don't know what the plan is with this. The backstory is a little wonky.
Yeah.
You know, so we'll just see, you know, we'll let it play out. But it's always fun to look at new stuff. Not to mention, I believe the first ones that broke it was third phase of the moon. So it's kind of hard to, I mean, I remember watching them first before I even got into this stuff. And I was just like, oh, come on. You know, that one's fake. That one's fake. That one's questionable. This, that, and the other. But yeah, check it out, man. I want to hear back from everybody on that.
Yeah. And you know, the great thing about, you know, being people like us and in this community and doing these shows for so many years is, you know, all the friends we have and people we know, you know, it's like as soon as somebody figures out, either authenticates it or, you know, proves that there's some kind of bullsh going around the situation, whether it's Eric or John or whoever, I'm going to hear it from somebody within like 20 minutes of that discovery. So I don't really have to worry about actually looking at all of them because eventually whenever it gets figured out, we'll hear about it. But the one common thing I'm hearing right now from everybody I've talked to is really the only common theory is not really a theory. It's just there's, you know, people are saying that it doesn't seem like if they are faked, there's no like fingerprint on it. It doesn't seem like it came from the same fakery. Like each one has its own style to it, you know, whereas, and we've all seen examples before of, you know, a batch of photos. You can they Photoshop it the same way in every one. They kind of leave the fingerprint on there. I've heard several people saying they're not seeing that with these. So that's interesting. But at the same time, this very, yeah, it just, like you said, the whole story is kind of wonky on how this came to be. So it's going to have to really impress in one way or another, to make up for that.
In a way, maybe they are making it wonky just to, you know, kind of be more low pro and not be so up in the face, you know, like mainstream, you know, media or news. But at the same time, you know, you can't, something that's so important, you can't start the story off with a freaking parking lot in Germany. I'm sorry, you know, not to mention, doesn't it rain in Germany a lot? It's like, come on, that thing, how long was it sitting there and this and that? Like, it just, it smells a little fishy, and we'll get to the bottom of it. If not, it'll be fun looking at it for sure. So no worries either way.
Yep. And okay, so, oh, by the way, guys, so now I think it's tomorrow. Some people in the Fringe FM chat room are saying it's tonight, but there's going to be a really cool roundtable show happening either tonight or tomorrow. We'll figure out in a minute here, but it's going to be Joe Roop of Lighting the Void, Ryan Gable of Secret Teachings, Clyde Lewis from Ground Zero is going to be on there. There's a couple other, it's a pretty all-star lineup. And
yeah, some heavy hitters. Awesome.
Yeah, and we got Joe and Ryan from the Fringe here. So yeah, that's gonna be, I'm pretty sure that's tomorrow, guys, or is it tonight? I don't know. Let me know in the Fringe chat room, which, by the way, real quick, I know we've got a lot of new listeners tonight, just from the interactions we've gotten in the last few hours. And for any of you new listeners, if you want to get in the chat room, we've got two of them. One is over at Spreaker. Which quickest way to get there is go to shifthappenspodcast.com. Look for the current episode playing in the episode player there. And right underneath the title, there's a little text message icon. Click that, and you're in there. And then the Fringe FM chat room, which is essentially just a link to the Discord channel, the ultimate chat room. Just go to the fringe.fm, click on chat at the top of the page, and you'll get an automatic invite into the Fringe FM Discord. And yeah, great way to get your questions in for the guest. There's always people sharing good links and what have you. And yeah, it's just that much more of an experience for you guys. So highly recommend checking out the chat rooms here. And so yeah, well, I mean, if it is tonight, we might have to stop this show to go listen to it. Okay. But yeah, okay. So that's that. And you know what I think we should do is, how about we take this break early? That way we'll have a little bit more time for the next segment with Preston here. And yeah, that way we won't have to break the flow just after a few minutes. So
most important, we get to hear some more rad music. So get your ears ready.
Indubitably indeed. Indubitably indeed. All right, ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Shift Happens here for the Fringe FM. I'm your host, Gigi, along with Brad Harris, and we'll be here in just a few short minutes with Preston Dennett. All right, see you soon.
Okay, here we go. AncientLifeOil.com. AncientLifeOil.com. Now, this is for CBD. AncientLifeOil.com. Again, for CBD. Where do I get CBD? AncientLifeOil.com. It's pretty good stuff. Organic, non-GMO. We are the Ferrari of CBDs. AncientLifeOil.com. You know, they say when you mention a person's name three times when you first meet, that you're going to remember. So I'd say to you, nice to meet you, AncientLifeOil.com. It's AncientLifeOil.com, right? Nice to know that you help people. AncientLifeOil.com. Think about this. Occasional stress, occasional anxiety, occasional inflammation, occasional stiffness, and intruders that get you down. AncientLifeOil.com. Okay, so I'm going to give you a fact for the day. So Ancient Life Oil does not help you with business deals. Hold on a second. If you feel better, it could help you make a better decision. Okay, I'm wrong. Just remember to go to AncientLifeOil.com.
From birth, we have been conditioned to conform to what is normal, conditioned to adhere to authority, and conditioned to repeat what has been told to us as truth. I'm Ryan Gable, and here at The Secret Teachings Radio, I've interviewed hundreds of great guests and done extensive unique research into subjects that span from the paranormal and the occult to health, philosophy, and history. I personally have no affiliations or agenda, except to use objective critical thinking in my analysis of every subject discussed, to empower myself with information, and hopefully allow you to do the same. If you want to join me, tune into the Secret Teachings radio broadcast, airing live Monday through Friday from midnight to 3 a.m. U.S. Pacific Standard Time on The Fringe FM. For more information, you can visit our website at www.thesecretteachings.info or email me at rdgable@yahoo.com.
Pure Health Defenders, proud sponsor of Shift Happens, producing organic and natural health, wellness, and technology products for people, pets, and plants to thrive alive. Pure Health Defenders, also known as PHD, is powered by C7 Technology, Scalar Energy Atomic Technology, and fueled by Sea Miracle Superfoods. 118 nutrients of the purest sea vegetables Mother Earth has to offer. Recognized 100% by people, pets, and plants, delivering the value the same. Everybody deserves a PhD. Be smart about it. Come join the healthiest family today.
Kids, don't drink in park. Accidents cause people. This has been a PSA brought to you by your friends at Shift Happens and The Fringe FM.
Hey guys, do you struggle with low testosterone levels? Symptoms of low testosterone affect your optimum functioning as a man, and this includes loss of motivation, fatigue, and lack of libido. Well, now there's a way to increase your testosterone levels and combat these symptoms, and do it naturally. How? It's called Red Stag for Men, the all-new male enhancement formula designed to do just that. Red Stag is formulated with some of the most frequently studied natural ingredients that are known to raise higher testosterone levels. Higher testosterone levels have been known to increase your drive, as well as reduce body fat, improve lean muscle mass, and boost your energy. Red Stag is taken once daily, yet works all day naturally. So go to MyRedStag.com right now and get your 60-day supply. Red Stag. Remember, take the red pill. Proven ingredients. Proven performance. Go to MyRedStag.com right now. That's MyRedStag.com.
Hey, is that a new music app?
Yeah, check it out, Surfer Music Discovery. It links to thousands of online stations, but the twist is you see the song names and artists that are now playing live.
That's different. No guessing. Looks like a waterfall of music.
So many formats. Rock, oldies, country, R&B, jazz, and a whole lot more.
How's that spelled?
Surfer. S-U-R-F-R.
Is it expensive?
It's free. No need to sign up or sign in.
Get the Surfer Music app free from Google Play or the App Store.
KTLK Digital Broadcasting. We rock the paranormal talk.
Hello. 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 Hello.
Fringe FM, this is Shift Happens. I'm your host, Gigi, along with associate producer here, Brad Harris.
Yeah, babe.
And we're here with Preston Dennett tonight in his new book, Schoolyard UFO Encounters, 100 True Accounts. Now, real quick before we get to Preston, just to clear up the confusion going on in the chat rooms. So apparently, that big round table show with Clyde Lewis and some Fringe FM folks is going to be tomorrow, but tonight, I believe Joe Roop and Ryan Gable are also, they're just going to be regular guests on his show tonight, leading up to the Big Round Table show tomorrow. So how cool is that? Definitely go check that out. Oh, yeah, no, I don't believe that's going to be on the Fringe FM. Kat, I'm pretty sure you're going to have to go to, go to, like, TalkStream Live and... You know, Clyde Lewis, he's usually, like, number one pretty much at all times. So you can just click on him there. Now, the roundtable show tomorrow, not sure. That might be a simulcast, actually. So we'll see about that. Either way, though, definitely don't want to miss that. All right. So without any further ado whatsoever, the author of the new book here, Schoolyard UFO Encounters, 100 True Accounts, as well as about 7,258 other books over the last couple of decades, one of the hardest working researchers in ufology, and currently the best, according to Eric Awakening Man. I'd like to welcome back to Shift Happens, and also to the wide world of Twitter as of this month, Preston Dennett. Didn't you, you just started a Twitter account, didn't you?
I did, yeah.
So what are your... So what do you think? How do you feel about Twitter?
I think I need to take a class on it, actually. trying to figure it out a little bit. I've just started, so haven't really been able to devote a whole lot of time to it. And it looks like a great way of connecting with people. And that's always good.
Yeah, definitely. And I'll give you a little pro tip right now, is you're going to want to get TweetDeck, which basically allows you to categorize and sort of turn Twitter into a chat room for you. It's kind of hard to explain, but yeah, TweetDeck. Once you have it, you'll never go without it. And definitely check that out. And so Preston, and welcome back. Now, and once again, folks, we'll be giving away a copy of his book tonight. Now, when did this book hit the shelves?
This one just came out a few months ago. Gosh, let's see, 4 months ago? Five? Second book I put out this year. I'm trying to put out two per year, which is a lot of work, but I've got some lined up for next year already.
That's insane. That's an insane amount of work. Your very first book, what was your very first book, by the way?
The first one I wrote was called One in 40, The UFO Epidemic, which really kind of covered cases from my family, friends, and coworkers. It took a while to get that one published. The first one that actually came out was UFO Healings. That was 1996 and covered about 100 cases of people who were healed as a result of a UFO encounter, physically healed.
Wow. And, to me, actually having the discipline to, no matter what the subject is, to just sit yourself down and write a book has always really amazed me. That's something I want to do sometime before I die, is write a book. But I feel like most people don't really have that sort of will in them, that very specific sort of determination that goes into writing a book. And that just blows my mind. And folks, if you thought I was kidding, type in Preston Dennett book in Google and you will see so many books. And let's put it this way. When did you, not, cause you still, you know, this isn't your full-time gig being an author. You've got a day job as well and always have. And there's more than 24 hours in one day for Preston Dennett. So
yeah, well, I wish. This is, it's something I kind of always wanted to do. You know, I do have a lot of passion for it, so I enjoy it for sure. When I got involved in UFO research in 1986, it took a year or two before I started writing about it really at all, and wrote articles almost exclusively for about, until 1996. So that would be 10 years. Of just, I didn't put out any books. I was just doing the research.
Yeah.
But boy, it hooks you. The subject grabs you and you just go deeper and deeper into it. And thought I'd have it figured out by now. No, I don't. I mean, this latest book, honestly, really shocked me. I could not believe what I was finding out.
Yeah, there are a lot of specifically school UFO sightings that have happened, and a lot of them very well documented, and most of them before the age of the internet. And speaking of before the age of the internet, especially for a guy like you, leading up to like 92, 93, 94, before internet was actually a thing you could really have, what were your go-to resources for information and research?
Oh, it was brutal, let me tell you. I mean, what was really helpful probably most was the UFO News Clipping Service, which clipped, newspaper articles from across the world, foreign and across as well as the United States. And boy, I had that for, 15 years, built a huge library. I would go to the libraries. There was UFO book services. And so that's how I kind of built up a lot of information about UFOs. Magazines, of course, were much more popular back then. So that's kind of what you had to resort to.
Yeah, what were some of the more popular magazines back in like late 80s, early 90s?
Oh, there was a slew of them. There was, UFO Library Magazine, UFO Universe, Unexplained Mysteries, UFO Encounters. You're taking me down memory lane. That was a while back. There's only a few surviving magazines really right now, print magazines. Most of it's on the internet.
Yeah, and there is something sort of inherently sad about that, whether it's, even if you collect movies or video games even, or magazines, I like that physical media. Everything's going digital now. Like there's you no longer get that, you know, that excitement of that magazine showing up on your doorstep. You know, it's either going to be Tuesday, Wednesday, or Thursday. You don't know which one. And then bam, there it is. Oh my God. You know, that, we don't get that anymore. It's just instant, you know, instantly. Oh, here it is. Okay. You know, that excitement's gone.
Yeah, I'm still a little old school. I do like the books, but it's gotten to the point where I can't do it anymore. I mean, the Kindle is a great idea. And I think about half the books sold now are on Kindle.
And are those ebooks or are they audiobooks?
Ebooks. Yeah, and the audiobooks. I have to get, you know, I'm trying to get some of my publishers to do the audiobooks because lots of people love those. I get constant requests.
Yeah, you know, I love audiobooks when it comes to, you know, if you're going to read something like Lord of the Rings or something like that. But when it comes to like research, I need to read that so I can go back and, you know, because otherwise I'm going to be rewinding that tape every 20 seconds, you know, trying to get all my facts straight. And do you narrate your own audiobooks when you do that?
No, but I'm going to look into that because I think it's definitely, you know, I know a lot of people who just don't read. They don't have the time for it. They don't want to do it. They want something that's, you know, more accessible. And we all drive. I was telling you earlier, I drive like 40 hours every month just going back and forth from work.
Yeah.
So that's a great opportunity for audiobooks.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. Now, so leading up to this book here, School UFO Encounters, here's a 2-for-1 question. What was the first case that came to your attention that, you know, out of all the cases in the book, what was the first one you came across? And then also, which case did you come across that was basically the breaking point where you said, okay, I've got to write a whole book about these?
Right. Yeah, I've got an answer to both of those. The first case was really one of my very first ever. I was asking around my family, friends and coworkers, have you seen a UFO? Because I was freaking out. I mean, I just found out this stuff was real. Heard a report on the news, November 17th, 1986. And I'm like, this can't be happening. And that's what's kind of motivated me to ask people. And was talking to my sister-in-law, who had seen a UFO with her two friends over Van Nuys Air Force Reserve Base, and then started telling me about this other experience she had, where she was walking in front of Stagg Street Elementary School near her home. Now, she wasn't a college student. She did go to this elementary school as a child. This was late at night during the summer of, late 1970s, or perhaps a little later. I'd have to look up the exact date on that. But at any rate, it's around 11 p.m. and she sees these two children standing in front of the school under the spotlight, the floodlight. And as she walks right up to them, they're like, you know, 5-10 feet away. She realizes they're not children. They're, you know, short, but they've got very large bald heads, dark glistening eyes. They're wearing olive green jumpsuits and are floating maybe an inch off the ground and kind of hover and turn towards her and lock gazes with her. And she completely freaks out. She realizes they're not human and walks away as fast as she can. And I'm thinking, you know, my gosh, you know, here's someone I know who's seen grays, but I'm looking in front of a school, honest to God, really?
Wow.
And yeah, so that was the kind of first case. Started getting a bunch after that and, you know, doing a lot of research and kept hearing about these schoolyard cases, but wasn't really connecting them together. I mean, I heard, you know, there's a Rua, Zimbabwe case, very well known, which a UFO landed at a school. There's another very famous case in Australia. And I started to think about this. I'm like, gosh, this is strange. And I looked up a few other cases, and I found out there was one in Florida. There was one in Wales. I thought, this might be an interesting subject. I wonder if they're UFO attractors, kind of like nuclear power stations or graveyards or rocket launches or just mines, you know, metal mines.
Right.
These are things that attract UFOs. And so I'm thinking about this and I'm like, well, let's do a little research. And I'm like, gosh, there seems to be a lot of cases. And I came across this one case and Cannot find it now. I don't know where it is, where I read this. It must have been on the internet in some obscure chat room or something. But this guy was talking about an encounter he had at school as a kid. He was in his classroom. He's, you know, like, I believe this was high school, could have been elementary school. And suddenly, these grays just walked in the middle of class. Everyone stopped moving. They were paralyzed. Apparently, he says it was like time stopped, actually. And these grays just started walking up and down the aisleways and doing stuff to the kids. He couldn't move. He couldn't shout out at this point. But he saw it all, and he was awake through the whole thing when suddenly it just snapped off, or they walked out, and time started rolling again, and everyone started talking as if nothing had happened.
Wow.
And so I'm like, yeah. I'm like, that's exactly what I thought. I'm like, all right, let's look into this. You know, let's see if this is a thing. And it definitely is. The files of MUFON and NUFARC are bulging with these kinds of cases. I found a bunch in, you know, my own library of books. I found some of my own cases that I'd already researched. You know, all the UFO organizations like, say, APRO and QFOS and NICAP, a bunch of cases from there. And I started adding them up, and yeah, found over 100 cases all across the world, stretching back about 100 years. 1950, really. But I found one case prior to that in 1853.
Oh, wow. Wow. Okay. Let's hear about the 1850. Give us a little, you know, give us a little hint as to what went on there. That's interesting, because I definitely haven't heard about this one.
Yeah. I was actually one of the earliest cases. I mean, it's a very early sighting, 1853, because UFOs were not really a popular at all. The term of extraterrestrials wasn't in the culture. Most things were considered to be astronomical phenomena, which is kind of what they thought this was. This was at Burritt College in Tennessee, and early in the morning, and these two lights were hovering over the school. A bunch of students saw it, teachers saw it, and these lights were there for, gosh, 20 minutes or so. One would get dim, the other would brighten up, and then that one would dim, the other would get brightened. They were putting on this kind of display or dance or something. And it wasn't anything anyone's ever seen before. You know, it wasn't ball lightning, or there were no aircraft back then.
Yeah.
So who knows? It's the only case that I could find for 100 years after that. Nothing. Oh, not over schools, I mean.
Hmm. Interesting. And immediately one correlation I can kind of link with that is, you know, that 100-year gap, maybe they were, you know, kind of busy with all the wars we were waging during that time. And then, you know, World War II ends, then here come the 50s, and then I get 1950s and seems to have picked back up after that. I wonder if maybe they were, you know, too busy dealing with all of us buffoons that were at war back then. Now, see, and that's really interesting too. You know, before anything before the invention of the airplane, obviously, is going to be really interesting. And even just some of the old paintings, you know, from some of the great artists over the last couple thousand years, you know, there's just straight up a flying saucer in their painting. You know, they go and examine the painting like, yeah, nope, this is an authentic painting. He painted that in there on purpose.
Right.
You know? And it's like, hmm, very, very interesting. Never endingly as well. Now we may have asked you this before, but obviously you worked with MUFON for quite a while as a field investigator. Now, before all of your professional work in this field, or even since, I guess, have you had any personal UFO sightings or encounters or experiences at all?
Not before I started investigating. No, none at all. And was very skeptical. But it wasn't long, really, before I buckled down and started really researching that I did start having sightings. I've had maybe a dozen over the last 35 years. And I'm going to say five. I was just, you know, counting them out. Five really good ones, which are, you know, hands down, I'm calling it a UFO.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot. The first time I ever saw anything strange, I went to a UFO meeting. This was very early on. You know, I just got into the field. And there's this contactee, and he says, okay, after I talk, I'll call down a UFO for you. I'm like, you got to be kidding. And there was must have been 50 people, maybe 100 in the audience. And I was shocked when only like 20 people showed up. I'm like, really? You don't want to see a UFO? Okay. Well, maybe this guy's full of it. I don't know. This is downtown Santa Monica. And we walk out in front of the building to this park. And you can't see a single star. It's just too bright.
Yeah.
This is, at night.
Yeah.
And we all get in a circle. And he's like, all right, let's meditate. Or hold hands and meditate, I think he wanted to do. I'm like, oh, no, great. Because there are cars driving by, and, this is not really what I signed up for. So we did. And he says, okay, look up into the sky right there. And he points. And he says, keep looking, it's coming. And it did. Right, maybe 10 seconds after he's pointed to the sky, this huge shooting star is what it looked like.
Yeah.
But it was impressive. I'm like, wow, what was that?
Wow. And... yeah, that's the thing too, because there's, we've all sat outside for meteor showers, right? We all know what a meteor looks like. It's got a trail of flames. It looks like a rock that's on fire falling through the sky. Like, okay, that's obviously what that is. But then there's those other things that people call shooting stars that are clearly not a ball of rock on fire. They look more like, somebody has a laser pointer and they're zipping it across the sky.
Right. That one was just ambiguous enough to really make me wonder, except for the fact that he pointed it out and kind of predicted it. But it was right after that, I had a sighting where I was driving home after staying up real late. I'm talking to my family about this subject because I was just going out of my mind with it. It's like 1992, I believe, maybe 93, late July, late at night, driving down this through Woodland Hills and about to hit Canoga Avenue when this little, I first thought it was a bird, but obviously wasn't. It came swooping down at a 45-degree angle out of the sky right towards my windshield and stopped right in front of it. I'm going to say 2 feet. Could have been a foot, but it was darn close. And this thing, this little ball of light about the size of maybe a golf ball, but maybe a little bigger, not super duper bright, but glowing and white, slid back and forth in front of my windshield, to the left and then to the right and then to the left and then to the right. And then it kind of went back to the middle, went forward, dipped down in front of my car, and then it went straight up. Mm. I look straight up. It's like there's trees there. It went straight up through the canopy of trees.
Yeah.
So I'm like, what was that? That was clearly unexplained.
Yeah.
So that's one of my best ones.
Yeah. I mean, once he starts, especially when you see him going up, that's obviously not a meteor. And and a lot of times, even people that are interested in UFOs and whatnot, even those of them that still haven't had their own experiences, I can't tell you how many times I've asked someone, when's the last time you just sat outside and looked up for a couple hours? Like, oh, I've never. Like, well, okay, there you go. That's why you haven't seen any. If you actually take the time and just post up outside, get your favorite lawn chair, get everything you need and just hang out for a couple hours, you will see some stuff. If not your first night, definitely your second night. And what's a, I don't know if you've ever seen one of these, but, we used to have me and my friends all the time, we would stay up all night and just look at the stars and have our guitars out there and just, the main activity being looking for UFOs, but, playing some music, in between sightings and whatnot, and just kind of hanging out and just making an event out of it. And when you do that, however many countless times, as we did, you're going to see some stuff. And there was one time where, we're looking at this constellation, and by constellation, I mean, we had come up with our own constellations. We didn't know what they were actually called, but there's this one that looks like a logo. It looks really similar to this old skateboarding logo that we all used to love back in the day. And so we're sitting there staring at it, and there's this random star kind of in the middle of it that I was pretty sure is not usually there. I'm like, Zach, is that star always there? He's like, no, because that changes the letter. You know, so we're sitting there, huh? And after a couple of minutes of trying to figure out if our memories are just bad or has this been there the whole time, and then all of a sudden, that star takes off. You know?
Wow.
And I mean, what was that? Have you ever seen one of those where they're kind of hiding out as a star, then they just take off after a couple minutes?
Not quite like you're describing. I have seen star-like objects kind of appear and disappear. And yeah, actually I have. And I hear so many more dramatic sightings, but I do know that these objects do mimic stars. There's one case comes to mind where this guy was being followed by a UFO, is right, you know, pacing him along the highway. And as soon as he gets into town or a gas station or any other car, it would zoom up and pretend to be a star. Then it would come back down and did that repeatedly. And there's numerous cases like that where they do that exact thing.
Yeah. And that is where really where it gets interesting is, especially, I'm sure, as you know, the more and more cases you look at, there are these common threads. There's a lot of events that have happened on, you know, where we store nuclear weapons at nuclear bases. That's one of these common ingredients. You know, we've had a lot of these sightings, not only sightings, but, you know, we've all heard of the cases where they actually deactivated some of the nuclear weapons in some situations. And so when you kind of step back and think about it, it's like, okay, yeah, I can understand why more advanced beings would not want us to be able to launch those things. Like, you know, they probably have some sort of dog in that fight in one way or another. It actually affects them, obviously, because they're sharing our existence too. They don't want to get blown up either. So that makes sense. We're talking about schools, though. And you've got a whole book and all these encounters that happened at schools. And I've got to say, as I'm thinking about it right now, it's not as obvious of a why would they hit a school situation. But obviously there's some common fact, you know, there's some reason why they're showing up at schools. What do you think that might be?
My first kind of thing was to determine if this is, you know, perhaps a coincidence. You know, are these just flybys? You know, perhaps the kids are outside. What's going on here? Because they are targeting schools. And that's what I found, is these are not flybys. These objects are coming, you know, from the horizon and coming directly over the schools and staying there. Most of these sightings occur during the daytime. They last longer than the average sighting. They're very low level, about, I'm going to say, 400 feet would be on the higher end, 1,000 feet, but usually a little bit lower than that. 30% of the cases involve landings and humanoids. Half the cases are of elementary schools. These cases involve, generally speaking, dozens of witnesses, you know, upwards of 50, 100, 200, 400 in some cases. Often there's a governmental response. There's a wave of publicity following these sightings. These are not your normal sort of average sightings by any means. And I think what we're looking at, just based on the behavior of the objects themselves, that I'm going to call them ETs, they're coming for the kids. They have an agenda of at the very least, showing themselves off. Because these are displays. These are long-lasting, low-level sightings that are clearly meant to be seen.
Yeah, and that's always a possibility too, is what if that is the whole point, is just to be seen? What if they're, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if that is the ultimate point in some of the sightings anyway, you know, where, you know, just imagine how much time we're, you know, spending trying to figure out why they were here. But what if that's it? What if that's why they were here? They just wanted to show their face.
I know it sounds kind of simple and obvious, but that does seem, I mean, to be the main agenda in these sightings. I think it does move a little bit beyond that as well, because it's not, I mean, what they're doing is creating sort of a universal belief in UFOs, certainly among the younger generations, which is basic, you know, what we're seeing right now.
Right.
Right? So I'm like, okay, well, this seems to be an effective strategy to sort of change those currents of human thinking or human thought, or, you know, how we think of ourselves and our culture in a sort of, I don't want to say underhanded way, but a quiet way that doesn't make waves.
Yeah.
In the way that, you know what I mean?
Yeah, that's exactly what I was getting at. Yeah, exactly. And yeah, they're kind of softening the psychological blow for the future generations when they eventually, you know, want to really coexist with us, which I think at some point we will sort of advance to that playing field, if you will, of participating in the universe, I guess. You know, maybe we get to the, eventually we'll hit that type one civilization status at some point. And yeah, there's got to be some sort of, you know, you don't want to hit them with all that all at once. You got to ease folks into the understanding of the existence of these people.
All right. Well, remember, these kids don't even know what a UFO is in most of these cases. They've never heard of it. It's not a term they've ever read or seen. So it's completely new to them.
Yeah. And yeah, it's definitely, yeah, I mean, if that is the strategy, that's definitely, that's the way to do it. Hit the schools, get them while they're young, get them used to the idea. And, you know, 50, 60 years later, they have kids. And now it's, you know, now it's easier to make your existence known. And you know, definitely limits the amount of hostility that, you know, let's not get it twisted. There's still people running parts of the world whose natural instinct to a UFO would be fire, shoot it down. You know, and, you know, that doesn't fairly represent all of us, because I know most people listening to this show would be like, hey, come on down. Let's hang out. Who are you? Where are you from? You know, we want to know. We're curious. And so, yeah, maybe they're helping push that right along. But, of course, we know that they're definitely up to stuff, too. They're definitely, you know, affecting things as well. But now when it comes to, well, how about this? We got to take a break real quick, but when we get back, let's go into some of these cases individually, and let's break some of these down. And and I bet a couple of these we'll be talking about tonight, even some of the most OG listeners here might not have heard of some of these. So yeah, definitely stick around, ladies and gentlemen. You're listening to Shift Happens here for the Fringe FM. I'm your host GG, along with our guest tonight, Preston Dennett, and we'll be back here in just a few short minutes. Don't go anywhere.
Tired of talking about the weather? No shift. Well, Shift Happens is here to fulfill your desires. As you reach that point in life where you crave tantalizing conversation about reality, ufology, the occult, and the conspiracies within, while simultaneously finding yourself desperately in need of your very own theme music, which we've got plenty of that too. So be sure to tune in to Shift Happens every Friday night from 7 to 9 Pacific, right here on The Fringe FM. Because the weather sucks, and you need some theme music.
ever seen an extraterrestrial? It can be hard to believe they exist unless you've seen one for yourself. What if I told you I've seen them my whole life, but have never had a witness who shared the encounter with me? Now, what if I told you I saw four of them, two with blue skin, and there are over 20 witnesses to this CE5 event? My new book, The Blue Beings, Visitation at the UFO Conference, documents actual accounts from real witnesses, many of which have gone on record to attest to this otherworldly reality. Be a part of a quantum paradigm shift that is taking place right now. Go to johnpolkmedia.com to get your copy of The Blue Beings, Visitation at the UFO Conference, on sale right now at johnpolkmedia.com. That's johnpolkmedia.com.
This is Ronnie LeBlanc, author of Monsterland, Encounters with UFOs, Bigfoot, and Orange Orbs, and you're listening to Shift Happens on KTLK, The Fringe FM.
KTLK Digital Broadcasting. We rock the paranormal talk.
Fringe FM. This is Ship Happens. I'm your host, Gigi, along with my associate producer, Brad Harris. What's happening, Brad?
What's up?
Righteous. All right, now, we're here tonight, folks, with Preston Dennett in his new book, School UFO Encounters, 100 True Accounts. Of which we're going to go a little in depth into some particular accounts in just a second here. Now, also tonight, we will be giving away one free signed copy of said book. And how can you win that? Good question, because I don't think we figured that out yet. But you know what we're going to do, though, is I think we're just going to open up the phone lines after the next break, the last half hour. We'll open up the phone lines, and we'll take multiple calls, but the first person that calls in and wants the book, they will get that copy. And there you go. Alright, so the chat rooms are popping. You know the deal. One of the chat rooms is over at Spreaker. Just go to our website, shifthappenspodcast.com. Look for the episode player. Click the chat room icon underneath the current title. Or you can hang out in the Fringe FM Discord chat. Just go to thefringe.fm, click chat, and bam, you're in there. And, oh yeah, by the way, if you do have questions specifically for the guests or something you want me to bring up on the show, and you're putting it in the chat room, make sure to put it in all caps. That way, it'll catch my eye, because sometimes these chat rooms just fly by, like tonight. All right, so getting back to some of these school UFO cases, let's start off here. Let's go to Australia, back in, I believe it was 1966, the famous the Westall case, which, although, kind of like we were talking about before the show, Preston, you know, although cases like these, especially this one, you know, if you ask, you know, any of our friends in this community, they'll tell you, yeah, they've heard about it, but at the same time, nobody really talks about it. It's just sort of this, you know, people, I don't know why they're not fascinated by it, because it's still just as fascinating as it was. Yeah, it was a long time ago, but pretty interesting case. And Dan James, speaking of which, Dan James in the chat room had this comment. He says, "One of the most interesting aspects of the Westall case for Dan was one of the students that got particularly close to one of the landed craft and passed out and was taken to a hospital. After a few weeks, her friends from school went to her house to go check on her, but they were greeted by a stranger at the door claiming that that family didn't live there, and this girl never returned to school either." And this is research that was done by Shane Ryan, who, if you've looked into this case at all, folks, he's, you know, one of the main researchers that comes up around this. And I believe there's a documentary on this as well. And so first, do you cover this one in your book, do you?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's a major case. It's one of the ultimate schoolyard encounters. There's been a number of researchers involved in this particular case. But Shane Ryan is definitely the main guy who did put out a documentary and has interviewed, I believe over 200 witnesses. The first real researcher was actually James McDonald, who was an atmospheric physicist and UFO researcher here in Arizona. So he researched it about 1 year after the incident. And in Australia, I can tell you, they do talk about it there. It's their most widely viewed case and probably their most famous.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. And you know what? I'm going to have to check out James McDonald. I'm actually writing this down right now. I'm going to check out his research after the show. Yeah, definitely one of their most famous cases. And so many witnesses. Now, actually, you know what, Dan James in the chat room, good point. That would be a lot of words to have done in all caps. nonetheless, yeah, if it's a short question, how about that? Put it in all caps. If it's long, put it in quotations. How about that? There you go. Now, one thing I can kind of, you know, I can understand why some mainstream coverage of it would have, you know, how they kind of may not have taken it so seriously, because a lot of people easily dismissed it with this. Oh, well, it was a bunch of kids. You know? And that's just not fair, for one. And then two, no, it wasn't just kids. Teachers and I believe even maybe even some police officers that arrived on the scene, I think, have even been interviewed and corroborated to the story to some extent. But as far as your research goes, what are some of the more credible folks? Well, I guess by that, I mean some of the adult folks that were there on the scene back in 1966 in Westall.
Yeah, James McDonald didn't interview one of the teachers extensively. And a lot of the students today are still speaking about it. It's an amazing case. The girl who fainted, they did find her eventually. She doesn't want to talk about it. But she did verify the incident. It's an amazing case. It all began when someone came running into the classroom saying that there were UFOs hovering over the field, over the oval. And all kids started running out of the classroom to see what this was. It was flying saucers, more than one of them, two, three. Planes started to show up. Cessna planes were circling these objects, trying to chase them. These objects were hovering, they were darting around, they'd disappear and reappear. And one of these came down in this area they call the Grange. It's a sort of a grove of trees right behind the school there. And this is what I see in all these cases, really. is when a UFO does land next to a school, it's like right behind it, right next to the playground in this little grove of trees. Over and over again, this happens. And these are high school students. There's 300 of them. They're running around. They're screaming. It's causing complete panic. A bunch of them hop the fence. They're not supposed to, but, you know, there's UFOs, and one has just landed. And they run up to this thing. And, yeah, this is one of the first people there was a little girl who fainted. Or not a little girl, a high school student. And about a dozen students got up to this thing, and it was sitting there in the ground. Heat was coming off of it. It was metallic. It was about the size of a small car. No features on it, really. And it lifts up, turns on its side, and darts off. The planes try to follow it. The planes eventually disappear. And by the time these students get back into the school, the police are there. The media has showed up. And the army is showing up with jeeps and full-on soldiers in camouflage. And they're pulling everyone into the school as fast as they can. The students who are, you know, close witnesses are pulled off into separate offices and questioned by the military about what they saw, told not to talk about it. And then there's a special assembly called by the headmaster who says, okay, there is no such thing as UFOs. If you think you saw a UFO, you didn't, you're sadly mistaken, but you can't talk about this. You're not to talk about this. And anyone who talks about it is going to get detention.
Wow. So,
yeah, there was really an instant cover-up on this thing. There was a few articles printed about it, and some researchers did sort of try to follow up on it. But it was effectively hushed. And to this day, researchers have not been able to find any official confirmation that the Army was there. Shane Ryan has interviewed some officials who did admit knowing about it, but we can't find the documentation.
Wow, how dare they? How dare they destroy that evidence? Now,
yeah, there was a teacher there, by the way, who was taking pictures. They took her camera, and yeah, it's a travesty.
Wow, and you know, honestly, this might just come off as sounding ignorant, but I've got to say, I'm kind of surprised. Like, I don't know. Out of any major government, I would imagine if any of them were to just genuinely arrive at a UFO scene, like not with these, you know, pre-planned agendas to cover it up, like you would think they would be the most actual, you know, open to what's happening government in that kind of situation. Like, I'm kind of surprised that they, you know, they did like a USA kind of job of getting there immediately, and it immediately did not happen officially, you know?
Yeah. Well, it was 1966. Today, they are much more forthcoming. I mean, there is a monument next to this school where this happened to permanently memorialize it. So that's amazing.
Yeah, and man, just imagine, that's one hell of a day for a kid. You know,
as if, right?
As if the UFOs weren't enough, then the military, and then the assembly in this whole, you can't talk about it. I mean, I wonder if one day, you know, like we used to do those bomb drills where you'd hide under the desk and go through all the motions. I wonder if they're going to have a UFO drill at some point for some of these schools.
That would be nice. Yeah, this, what's amazing about this case, there was an airport, you know, not far away. Gosh, I think it was like 3 miles, 2 miles, something like that. They called up the airport. They're like, no, we didn't see anything. And they're like, well, what about those five planes? What? And the airport's basically, what five planes, you know? So they've tried to track these pilots with zero success. And this is a pattern we see in these cases. 1 year later, Opa-locka, Florida, literally to the day 1 year later.
Oh.
Same thing. The only real difference between the Westall High School case and what happened at Crestview Elementary School is the age of the kids. These were elementary school in Opa-locka, Florida. April 1967, bunch of UFOs shows up, and one lands right behind the school there. The kids didn't run up quite up close to it. And this time the Air Force shows up and cuts the school day short again, and pulls people into their classrooms, and, you know, people who walked to school, rode their bikes, were allowed to leave, and the rest had to, you know, go on school buses. And again, basically not so much told not to talk about it, but told that what they saw was helicopters, which is ridiculous. And again, there's an airport right next door who denied everything.
Yeah, and they're... and Kat brings up a good point in the chat. She says, you got to remember that in the 60s, the aerospace industries were in full-blown research and development mode. And that could lead some credence to how they responded to some of these events. I guess that does make a little sense. Comparing Australia to Florida here, first of all, in either case, was there any sort of physical evidence as far as, you know, maybe radiation burns in the ground where the craft landed, or did anybody come away with any of that, or did they just cover that up real quick?
It was covered up. That certainly did happen in the Melbourne case. At Westall High School, there was landing traces. Shane Ryan has interviewed a lot of people who saw these and have confirmed it, but it was burned over and plowed over. God, I think it was like 2 days after the incident. Pretty quickly, it was roped off and people weren't allowed to go there. And then it was destroyed. There are landing traces in other cases. There's another case in South Africa at Rosemead School where an object landed on the high school tennis courts and just tore it up. There's photographs of this. It was studied by the police and several, you know, scientific investigators who could not determine what happened. Wasn't a windstorm. They just couldn't figure it out. It was very strange. All the tar, floor of the tennis courts were. Well, they found a piece like a half mile away on a hill.
Oh wow. Yeah. Now, okay. So when was that one? The one in South Africa.
I have to look that up. I do have the date of that, but I think it was like mid-70s. These occur, on the average, about two per year since 1950. And that's just the ones I found. I'm guessing it's 100 times more common than what, you know, is presented in this book, at least.
Wow. Oh, yeah. And it's funny. Somebody just asked about the South Africa one, too. Gene's asking the audience, what part of South Africa was that?
That was... Rosemead, South Africa. Rose in Middelburg, South Africa. That was November 12th, 1972.
Interesting. Okay. And now, so taking a step back, let's just take these three cases for example. Were there any similar as far as the recounts of the situation with the students or be it teachers or who, what have you, were there any sort of common denominators as far as any of their stories or their, their impression of the event or, for example, did some kids claim to hear somebody talking to them telepathically? Was there any sort of common takeaways from the experience?
Right. Well, I mean, in the Westall case, no, we don't have that. There's one outlying guy who says that there were humanoids and he was abducted. His case is pretty controversial. He's kind of recently said this. So, there are people who are skeptical about it. But generally, all the witnesses agree on the appearance of the craft. And there are, like, the Rua Zimbabwe case. There's about five or six really famous cases. And probably the ultimate case of this kind occurred in November 1994 in Rua Zimbabwe, pretty rural area, where 200 kids were on the playground. No teachers, by the way. There was one teacher on the playground minding a snack stand. She didn't see this thing. A number of students didn't see it. About 60 at least saw this object land. It's a very large playground, a very big field at the end of the playground, just beyond the border there, which was not a fence. It was just sort of chopped down eucalyptus trees, logs. And a being approached. There were actually three beings. One at least came very close to a small group of students, and they did receive messages. So not all... We have 62 students who saw the landed UFO and a much smaller number who saw the humanoids, and just a handful of kids who got messages. But the messages, oh man, this is 1994. Environmentalism is not really a big thing back then. Yeah. Certainly not in Zimbabwe, where it's very wild.
Right.
And these messages were all about that, about the dangers of pollution, one child was told. Another was told, you know, that we have to stop chopping down the forests or humanity will suffer from it and perish. Another student was told we are becoming far too technological. We're using technology in the wrong way. There's a right way and the wrong way, and we could do much better. So all of these kinds of messages were what was coming across.
Yeah, and very interesting. And also, you know, John Polk's got a good term for this. I might be getting the term wrong, but essentially what he calls, you know, like alien amnesia or alien induced amnesia. I'm not sure if John Polk's ever gotten to sit down and tell you that whole story about the blue beings at the UFO conference. But one common takeaway from everybody there was this sort of like, it was to the point where after the sighting, 10 minutes pass, and if you would not have mentioned the fact that that had just happened 10 minutes ago, they would have never remembered it otherwise. There's just this sort of hazy, foggy memory that people seem to get in a select some cases, I would say. Was there any signs of that happening at Zimbabwe here?
Not really, but there is some confusion about time. There are a number of students who said events seem to move in slow motion, and that's a red flag. I hear that in a number of these cases. There was a case in Scotland at Elder Park Elementary School where the witness was asked how long the sighting lasted, and she's like, well, I couldn't tell you. Time seemed to stop, and other people have, you know, told me that directly. Yeah. And literally, in some cases, time did actually seem to stop. I mean, people weren't moving. So that's a possibility. There's, you know, some researchers have speculated that the Rua Zimbabwe case was more than a sighting, that these kids could have been taken on board. How would we know? And there's a case in France where nobody remembered it. And one day, you know, the husband's talking to his wife, and he's like, have you ever seen a UFO? And suddenly this sighting came flooding back into her mind of this when she was in boarding school in France, and this triangular object came right over the school, and everyone was gasping. No one was talking. They all just stared at it, and it moved on, and then everyone forgot about it. It was not a topic of conversation. Nobody was just like it didn't happen.
Yeah, that's that alien-induced amnesia right there, and yeah, there are a lot of cases that have that, but nonetheless, we do have the, yeah, it's really fascinating to me that, you know, all these kids were getting these messages, be it telepathic, I guess, or what have you. Now, how do you, just in your personal opinion, when it comes to, I mean, there's so many different examples of other beings coming down to basically, you know, make themselves seen and make the point of, which is basically, hey, stop it, cut it out, stop blowing stuff up, stop polluting. You know, there seems to be these points in history where they feel an actual need to come down here and actually stop us for a second and kind of shake us a little bit. Hey, stop it. You know what I mean? What do you think that's more out of, kind of like we're talking about earlier, where we're sharing the same earth, we're sharing the same solar system, we're sharing the same play field. Please don't blow it up for all of us. Or do you think maybe it's more personalized towards us, where maybe it doesn't really matter to them, they're actually just looking out for us particularly, or do you think it's in their own interest as well?
Well, I don't have any direct evidence really to say You know, I can only speculate. But they're sure interested in us. And that message, that environmental message, is the number one message, has been ever since this phenomenon started in the 1950s. If you're talking about the contactee era, you know, George Adamski and Truman Bethlehem and Howard Menger and all those guys, that message was very popular, you know, nuclear proliferation and pollution and warlike ways. Carried on through the grays. I don't care if you're talking to the praying mantis or the human-looking ETs or what. It's the number one message. So that speaks, I think, to their agenda, which does seem to be very personal towards us. There's something, for some reason, they're very concerned about us and our planet.
Yeah.
I don't know, though, because, you know, this all kind of rolled out real strong, right, coinciding exactly with the nuclear age. We're suddenly exploding all these bombs. Our technology is out of control. And that's when they showed up in large numbers, the, you know, 1947, really specifically, and just haven't gone away. This is kind of unprecedented in human history. We've never had anything like this.
Yeah, and it's so painstakingly obvious if you just take the time to look at the last 70 years. You know, and I in a sense, I think I kind of get it. You know, if we were, you know, normally we know monkeys live in the jungles, but we don't go in there and mess with their stuff. We let them be, you know, let them do monkey things out there in the jungle. But then all of a sudden, what if one day we woke up and we start hearing these explosions coming from the jungle, and then we go in there and we find a monkey that has made his own grenade launcher out of coconuts and some sticks. We're like, okay, we need to stop this now. You know, I can understand, you know, put that in a bigger perspective. Like, yeah, maybe it's not the best idea in the world to give humans nuclear power right now, you know, or at least certainly not how we were using it back in the 40s. Yeah, that must have been a pretty big scare for any other beings in the solar system. I'm sure they heard, if not felt, if not saw, the rumblings of those nuclear attacks back in the 40s. And, you know, the more you think about it, it's like, oh, of course they're coming down here and telling us to stop. Why wouldn't they?
Yeah, well, I mean, speaking more directly to that, there are a number of accounts where ETs have told people that our nuclear explosions did cause ripples in other dimensions that we're not aware of. Damage.
Yeah, that's the other one, too. And, and like Doc Ram said the other day to me, you know, not only could it be affecting other dimensions, it actually could be affecting other dimensions more than it's even affecting our own. And yeah, you can trip on that for a while.
Yeah, well, UFOs are all about nukes. I mean, not only are they hovering over our nuclear power stations, our nuclear missiles, and shutting them down, some of them appear to be powered by nuclear power because people who get too close to them suffer what appears to be radiation sickness, or certainly mimics it, right?
Definitely. And there's accounts of that going back to the Bible, quite literally, actually. And we could branch off into so many different discussions right here. But here's what we're going to do. We're going to take our last commercial break. I'm going to try to shorten it as much as possible. And then when we come back, we'll open up the phone lines. And we'll take some calls and see where that'll take us. So, ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Shift Happens here for the Fringe FM. I'm your host, Gigi, and we're here tonight with Preston Dennett and his new book, Schoolyard UFO Encounters, 100 True Accounts. And we'll be right back in a few short minutes with your calls. Don't go anywhere.
Truth? Are UFOs real? Are aliens visiting Earth? Are governments around the world hiding the biggest secret in history? We're UFO Seekers, official partner of The Fringe FM, and we're on a hunt for the truth. Join us as we investigate locations like Area 51 by subscribing on YouTube at youtube.com/UFO Seekers.
Are you intrigued by Paranormal Talk Radio? You'll love the new Paranormal Radio app from TalkStream Live. You'll find a great selection of talk shows covering UFOs, ghosts, strange phenomena, and much more. Download the Paranormal Radio app now and start listening to the very best in paranormal talk entertainment, including the network you're listening to right now, the Paranormal Radio app, free in Google Play and the iOS App Store.
All right, man, this is Crow 777, and you are listening to The Fringe FM.
So, you love talk radio, then you'll love TalkStreamLive.com. TalkStream Live is always on, 24-7, with the best streaming talk shows. Find your favorite talkers and discover some new ones. It's free, readily available online or on mobile with any smartphone or tablet. Finding your favorite talk shows all in one place has gotten a whole lot easier. Just go to TalkStreamLive.com. Be sure to download the free apps from Google Play or the iTunes App Store.
Want to know what's on The Fringe FM? Check out our schedule at thefringe.fm.
Don't feed the Archons. Feed ducks instead. And listen to Shift Happens on The Fringe FM. Fridays, 7 to 9 p.m. Pacific. Cortana out. Quack.
Okay, nurse, let's get this man to the ER, stat.
Right away, doctor.
We see this every day. Heart attack or angina pain due to blocked and clogged arteries. Chelation can remove obstructions or blockages from arteries and help avoid painful and expensive surgery. Now there's Angioprim. It's a liquid oral chelation product that you take with juice. You start to feel the results fast. Angioprim increases blood flow all over the body, and that means more energy and strength to take on the day with less aches and pains. 60 years of research has gone into chelation. And Angioprim is the result, a safe and easy way to unblock your veins and arteries from buildup that slow circulation.
Paging Dr. Jones, please report to the emergency room right away.
Log on now for a special radio offer from Angioprim. That's angioprim.com/radio. A-N-G-I-O-P-R-I-M. Angioprim.com/radio or call 877-882-7221. That's 877-882-7221.
Live for 3 hours every Saturday night. It's a show that engages the mind, makes you think, and maybe even challenge what you think you know. Hi, I'm Jeremy Scott of Into the Paranormal, where we talk about topics that are anything but mainstream, somewhere between abnormal and paranormal. Bring an open mind and join us for Into the Paranormal. Live Saturdays at 6 p.m. Pacific, 9 p.m. Eastern on The Fringe FM.
KTLK Digital Broadcasting, TheFringe.fm, Napa Valley, California, Little Rock, Arkansas.
We're back for The Fringe FM. This is Shift Happens. I'm your host, Gigi, along with my associate producer tonight, Brad.
Hello.
Harris. And, all right, 1 second, caller. Yeah, we'll get to you in just a second. But, yeah, welcome back to the show, folks. And, well, as you've guessed, we do have a caller on the line. And sorry for that bit of phone tag there. Not sure what happened there. But you're live on Shift Happens with Preston Dennett. Who art thou, caller?
I am Lisa Allen. How are you?
Oh, hey, what's happening, Lisa?
Yeah, so I might have missed like whether I'm supposed to do something or say something. I just saw the phone number on the Spreaker chat, so I'm just calling.
Oh, all right. And
but you can tell me what it is. I still might be able to participate.
Well, for starters, if you want, you are, since you the first one to call in, you are the official winner of the signed copy of Preston's new book, Schoolyard UFO Encounters, 100 True Accounts. Would you like that book?
Heck yes. Yes.
All right. Fantastic. And, oh yeah, by the way, Lisa, I don't know if you got my message on Discord, but yeah, I didn't see all those messages. I didn't realize that those were messages up there. I thought those were other channels. So.
Oh, got it. No worries. This is why Discord, it's kind of wonky, you know, like that's why it's anyway, never mind. You got my message. That's all that matters. So yes, I responded. It looks like I'm looking around here, and it looks like you are either collecting a UFO story or questions for Preston. Pardon me.
Yeah, we're definitely taking questions.
Okay, I don't have any right this minute. But do you guys want a story? I don't tell many people about this.
All right. We got a couple minutes here. Go ahead.
Okay. It was 2000 and I was driving back and forth between San Diego and Montana. And one time I was coming back down to San Diego and I was awake, you know, very rested, the middle of the night. And I ended up, next thing I knew, like being around Area 51, falling asleep at my car ran off the road. And I thought it was really weird. And I was missing about an hour and a half of time. And I missed my exit, and I had to drive right by Area 51. And then I looked at my car. I was seeing if it was okay. It looked fine. And when I got to San Diego and woke up in the morning, my whole right side of my car was crunched up.
Oh, wow. Wow.
Yeah. And that was definitely, and I have missing time, everything. Like, it's pretty crazy.
Yeah.
I had a person that did kind of a healing on me. He does like UFO healing type stuff. He's really cool. He lives in Montana. By the way, there's lots of stuff that goes on in Montana. And it turns out that they were kind of mad at me. So apparently I'm one of their generational experiments. They probably kidnapped my mom and kidnapped my grandmother and, you know, like that kind of stuff. And he told me I changed my DNA somehow, that they couldn't use me anymore, and they were pissed, and that's why they, like, had me run off the road.
Huh.
Scared the hell out of me. Yeah.
I've definitely never heard a story quite like that. Very fascinating.
No, neither have I.
Yeah, I've definitely never heard some of those points there. Maybe one of these times... I've got actually kind of similar experience, other than they weren't mad at me. I don't think that part was not there, but yeah, when you lose time like that, it really shakes your understanding of what reality is when you have an experience.
Well, and
like
that I fell asleep at the wheel and missed my exit when I was very well rested. I mean, I deliberately, was well rested. I had nothing wrong with me at the time. So that's what, and then when my car, like when I'm in the area, like they make it appear like nothing was wrong with my car. And then when I get to San Diego, like I totally see what happened to my car and it was not cool.
Wow.
They were not nice to me. They couldn't use me. Yeah. Eric says, how dare you change your DNA?
Yeah.
Guess what, Graves? You guys are extinct now. Here's my middle finger, right?
Right.
Yes, I was driving alone. I was actually coming to San Diego to get an apartment rental set up, and my kids were in Montana, and I was back and forth at the time trying to like work that out. So
wow, yeah, that's
that was in 2000.
That's quite a commute, and maybe one of these nights whenever we do open lines, we might have to have you call back in and really go into depth into this story. But thanks for calling in. We appreciate it. And yeah, we'll get that book right out to you, and it'll be signed by the man himself, Preston Dennett.
Awesome. And nice to meet you, Preston. I'll probably be seeing you at some point soon.
Yeah, I hope so. Nice to meet you, too.
Awesome. Right. Talk to you later.
All right. Thanks. Take care, Lisa.
Bye.
Bye. All right. There we go. So there's a winner of the evening. Okay. Now we got another caller coming in. All right. Let's go ahead and take this. Might be the last call we can take tonight. All right. Here we go. And, oh. Okay, whoever just tried calling, call back in. We need you to call back in. Yeah, for some reason, it's dropping some of these calls like hot potatoes. I'm not sure what's going on here. Oh, nope, we can't do that. Okay, yeah, whoever just called, call back in. Try it again, and we'll get you in here. Okay, there we go. So now, okay, while we wait for that call. So Preston, Kay makes a good point. This would be Fran's fault, indeed. That's why we mentioned that in the credits. How dare you, Fran? Now, out of all the cases that you cover in your book, what would you say, which one do you think is the most, you know, the most of a smoking gun relative to the rest of them?
Well, each case, most of a smoking gun. It's a great question. There's a couple of cases that occurred one right after the other. The Jerome Elementary School case, which was followed a year later by the Whitsett Elementary School case. And in both these cases, these objects came low over the playground and were witnessed by, in the first case, it was 60 children, and the other was like 150. And they dropped what we now know, what we call angel hair, which is a sort of cotton candy, spider webby type substance, which generally speaking dissolves on contact, but didn't in these cases. It coated the schools in both these cases, covered the playground. Students were able to pick it up, and samples were sent in the first case to the local Lockbourne Air Force Base, who neglected to respond to inquiries about, you know, what the analysis showed. Whereas in the second case, in both these cases, the government was very interested in what was going on. The second case, they saved a sample and sent it off to Burlington Scientific Labs, who were not able to identify it. They thought it was a biological substance and suggested sending it off to a biologist, which they did. They thought it might be spider webs. The biologist says, no, it's not spider webs. There's way too much of it. There's no evidence of spiders. It's far too uniform. But I like those cases because they were very widely viewed. The government was paying very serious attention to them. They got a lot of publicity and had physical evidence.
Yeah, that is really fascinating. And hopefully we can go into that a little more after the call here, but let's see what we... Okay, caller, who art thou? I think I know who it is.
This is Eric, the Awakening Apprentice.
The Awakening Apprentice, that's right. Hey, what's happening, Eric?
Yes, hey, how you guys doing? How you doing, Preston?
I'm doing good. How are you?
Good. So I got a question for Preston. I'm guessing you heard just about every story, but I'm wondering maybe this one, but you might not have heard it. Are you familiar with a guy by the name of Adam Ambrose?
Can't say that I am, no. Adam Ambrose?
Okay, cool. I can actually share a story with you that you haven't heard, which is almost impossible. Gigi, you remember Adam Ambrose?
Is that the Adam from back in the, when I used to do Beyond the Strange?
Yeah, the late 2017 and then 2018. He did the, you interviewed him, I think I did, and then also John Polkham, and then also Jimmy had him on the show.
Yeah, man, I love that guy. Where's that guy been?
He just kind of vanished. I don't know what the deal was, but anyway, let me tell the story, and then I want to know if I'll make it brief, though. But I want to know if Preston has ever heard a story like this. So Adam is, I believe he's in his 50s, maybe middle 50s. So, you know, he went to school in New York. And what he says is that in his school, where he went to school, he was an abductee already. And then they would have these mass abduction events where he was actually, this is going to sound kind of crazy, but ufology is crazy, so maybe it won't sound crazy, but he actually was part of the, I guess the Greys or whoever these beings were, kind of co-opted him and trained him in essence to assist in this abduction, this massive school abduction. And it happened, I think it happened more than once, but on one particular occasion, they came and they took everybody in the entire school in this abduction. And then there was a situation. If you really want to hear the whole story, Preston, one day I'll send it to you on Twitter and you can listen to it because it's pretty interesting. But in one of the cases, he ran into the, what was it? Who's the guy that takes the custodian in the bathroom. And the custodian had seen one of these aliens, communicating with Adam at the school, and it freaked the custodian out. And the custodian, I remember Adam recalling that the custodian asked him, do you know those guys or are those aliens? Do you remember that part of the conversation, Gigi?
Now that you mention it, vaguely. Yeah, I do remember the story.
Yeah, vaguely. I mean, it's a long story. I mean, he told the story. I mean, he can go two and a half hours. But then later, this would have been about 1980-ish, I would say, in that time frame. This is when this happened. But it was, I don't think it was ever researched or it was never reported, because he says that that this was kind of his role, because he was like a senior abductee. And then he would, when they had these mass abductions, he was kind of there to kind of keep the kids calm, but they would never remember anything. Maybe he did say there was a few kids that had memory, but they wouldn't talk about it. And then he had got to a point where I think he convinced one of the kids that now they're adults now to kind of verify his story. And then that's when he kind of disappeared. So, have you heard of a story like that before, where there was like a mass abduction at a school or anything like that before, Preston?
Yeah, I have. Boy, I wish I had heard about this case before I put this book out, because this is exactly, it's exactly what's going on here. There's a couple of cases like that. There was one that occurred up in Missouri, where there was a group of female students having a sort of slumber party at the school gym. And a UFO landed next to the school, kind of stopped time, apparently, and walked right in and took about four of the girls out and did an abduction and put them back. Not a mass abduction, but there was another case. Oh, gosh, I'd have to look up exactly where it occurred. It was in the U.S. And one kid had missing time on the playground. Everyone was looking at this UFO, and suddenly recess is over and he's getting back in line. Everyone's staring at him like, where were you? And following that evening, he had a dream in which he recalled being on board this object, and all the students were there and they were being given all these various sort of telekinetic tests and things like this. So there are, cases like that. There's another one up in Ocean Knoll Elementary School in Northern California, Grass Valley, I think it was. I forget exactly where. But same type of thing. And this lady said this went on for years, where UFOs, would come to the school and visit students during recess and playground and kind of disguise themselves as children, but they were really Greys, and were taking children regularly.
Wow. I got to read your book. And I mean, this is, we talk about disclosure, I don't know that, even though the books I'm sure is fantastic, I don't think the public's ready for this kind of disclosure. I mean, I am, but I don't think the public is. You know what I mean?
Yeah, they're going to get it one way or another. I don't know. I don't know how it's going to all roll out, but, I can't see this going the other direction.
No. So now, I remember last time I called in last time you were on the show. I think it was a few months ago or whenever, but you had just recently, your job situation was such that you're going to be able to get maybe a little more free time on the weekends. Is that starting to open up for you yet? Because I still want to go out to Catalina Island with you. Remember I told you I'd take you out there and we can do some little research? I don't know if you remember that or not.
Yeah, I do remember. Yeah, it's still extraordinarily busy, but you know, always willing to schedule time for, you know, this is what we live for, to do this kind of stuff. This is, you know, that's where my passion is. This is the fun stuff. Work, couldn't care.
Even if you had to call in sick, right?
Right.
Yeah, I'll keep it in mind. There's, I definitely want to get there. I haven't looked at the weather situation. I really don't know if there's a winter even on Catalina Island. Is it? Is there a rainy season? Is there a winter in Catalina Island, or do you know what the weather's like?
Yeah, the next couple of months are probably going to be pretty, you know, wintry. But okay. I don't know. You know, weather these days, especially.
Yeah, maybe we could do it in February or March or something. Hopefully, after when spring comes or something like that, maybe.
Yeah.
But, yeah, that's all I really wanted to ask you about. But, yeah, I'll send you on Twitter, I'll send you the link to the interview that we did with Adam Ambrose. And I think you'll find it interesting. When he first came out with the story, though, I think he was the first guy that I remember publicly recall. I mean, not you, but I remember someone publicly doing an interview about that type of stuff. And I was a little skeptical. But you know, now that you've written this book and now there's all these other cases, then this is kind of teaching me that maybe that Adam was telling the truth and that he was just, you know what I mean? It's one of those kind of deals.
Fits right in with the cases I've been researching. Yeah.
Do you ever, when's the last time you were fooled? I mean, do you recall a case that you were recently that maybe in the last 2 years that you started to look at and then you thought, wow, this is interesting. And you're kind of thinking maybe this is real. And then all of a sudden, something pops up in your discernment, you know, and you realize, oh man, I don't think I'm buying this one. And you recall anything on that?
Doesn't happen a lot. I mean, yeah, I was interviewing a guy who I think his story is real, but it just started to get so wild that I'm like had to sort of back up a little bit. And I think he's sincere, but I'm not sure he's accurately reporting what happened to him.
All right, yeah, I know you've got a few minutes left. Good talking to you guys, and we'll stay in touch. I'll talk to you guys later.
All right. Thanks for calling in, Eric. All right, there we go. Now, we've only got a couple of minutes here. So real quick, I've got the link to your website out in the chat rooms. But for those not in the chat rooms, let's go ahead and give them your website, where they can follow you on Twitter and social media and all that good fun stuff.
Yeah, I'm new on Twitter. Gosh, what is my handle? Hashtag, is that what you call it?
I actually know it. It's at Preston E. Dennett.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was going to say. And my website is also my name, PrestonDennett.Weebly.com. If you just Google my name, it should take you there. I got all my books there. You can contact me through my website. I always love to hear from people, whether you know they've got a comment or a question or a story to share. And, yeah, thanks for having me on the show again.
Definitely. And are you going to be coming out for Conscious Life Expo or maybe even Contact in the Desert this coming year?
I hope so. I did Contact in the Desert last year, which I had a blast. My most recent upcoming engagement is UFO Con 2020 up in Northern California. That's in February 20th, 22nd, around there. But after that, I'm pretty wide open. I'm expecting to do another one in April, and we'll see.
All right. Fantastic. Fantastic. Well, yep, we're pretty much, yeah, we got to run right now. But thank you so much for coming on, Preston. We really appreciate it. And and thanks for donating that book for Lisa, too, as well. I know she's going to absolutely love it.
Hey, my pleasure. Yeah, it's always a blast talking to you guys. Really appreciate it.
All right. Thanks again, man. We'll talk to you soon. All right. How about that, Brad? And
yeah, amazing, amazing. All those cases, man, off the top of his dome. He's just a steel trap of memory right there, Preston is.
Absolutely. And, yeah, hopefully, okay. In the chat rooms talking about the $15 sandwiches. How can you forget? As soon as you say Conscious Life Expo, you know you're buying some $15 sandwiches, son. But yeah, you gotta love it, you know. You gotta love it.
Now, it's all about the chicken quesadilla, remember?
Yeah. Well yeah, that's the honestly that's the move. With Contact in the Desert at the new location, no matter how much you want something else, you have to get the quesadilla. It's the only thing that makes sense at the time. It really is an amazing phenomena there at CITD.
Yeah,
Indian
and it's Wells. $9.75.
Yeah, at least that's kind of acceptable, whereas, you know, like a bagel with half a piece of sausage on it for $15 at Conscious Life, you know? But you gotta love it. Whatever makes that conference happen, you know what? I'll support it. So there you go. All right, ladies and gentlemen, thanks for tuning in tonight. Now, normally Joe Roop is live with Lighting the Void right after us here on the Fringe FM, but right now, Joe and Ryan Gable, both from the Fringe FM here, are live right now with Clyde Lewis. Just go to TalkStreamLive.com, click on Clyde Lewis. He's right there at number one. And we were number five all night tonight. That was pretty cool. So, so definitely check that out, guys. And like I mentioned earlier, we will be doing a live B-Sides and Rarities episode this Sunday at 5 o'clock Pacific time with me and Cortana in a roundtable of folks talking about some nerdery. All right. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, this has been Shift Happens here for the Fringe FM. This show is hosted and produced by yours truly. You can follow me on Twitter at ggrabbit1. Social producer is Brad Harris. Where can they follow you, Brad?
Hey, Brad Harris with a big hat. Have fun. Rip it up this weekend.
All right, there you go. Special thanks to Eric Awakening Man, our roaming reporter. Also, special shout-out to Dennis Koch for all the promotional goodness that he does. And as always, all blames and faults go to Fran. That's right. Hashtag Fran's fault. All right, folks. Time to listen to some good old-fashioned Clyde Lewis. We'll see you guys on Sunday. And if not then, we'll see you next week. And if we don't, have a great Thanksgiving. We'll see you all sooner than later. Cheers, folks.